I'm Joshua Finn from J&H Aerospace. This is a Keelcraft Gypsy that is built from a Keelcraft kit sold under the RipMax brand. It needs a propeller. The kit comes with a 12-inch plastic propeller, which I'm sure for a sport flyer will provide enough performance that you would enjoy flying the airplane on a small field. However, I want to make this airplane fly the way it was intended to. Therefore, I have the perfect opportunity to do a build video that several of you have requested and that I've been wanting to make for a very long time. So today, we're going to make a carved propeller. This is an example of a moderately okay propeller that I made. This is carved from a built-up block, but it was carved as a single piece, split it in the middle, turn it into a folding prop. For competition rules, the Gypsy is not allowed to have a folding prop. It is a single piece freewheeling propeller, so that provides us some extra things and an excuse to make another one of these videos later so we can do this. There are a variety of methods for making carved propellers, so let's talk about a few of those before we get started. The traditional way to make a carved propeller is to make it from a single block of wood, as you would see with this blade on an authentic John Barker Hepcat. The hub and the propeller were carved from a single block of wood that was cut to an initial profile, and then I carved and sanded it down to get this shape. There is a set of dimensions that you use, and you can get this exact, and this is a funny, there's an interesting profile to this shape. You can carve a block that will consistently allow you to arrive at that shape every time. Another method for creating a carved propeller is this Wakefield propeller from the Wales Thomas collection. These blades are actually formed of layers of balsa build up on top of each other on a curved block, and afterwards they are sanded to shape, doped, tissued, etc. to give a really nice result. The most common solution nowadays for mass production are propellers from pre-carved blanks that are carved on a helical jig so that you get this shape. These have been around for many years. They've been around since the 1930s. A variety of different formats, some with little tips already set up. Here's a three-blader. You can get blanks like these from blairproducts.com under the Superior Props brand. And the ones from Superior will look kind of like these. So you'll see a little bit of a funny profile at the end. So they're constant thickness out there. That's probably the most popular option. They're not cheap, but they're worth it because you get a block that's from relatively consistently graded wood. For example, some of these are hard and some of them are just from absurdly light wood that I'd be almost scared to use if I was going to sand it down to an efficient airfoil shape. Because one of the issues that you have to deal with is to make a good propeller, you've got to carve it fairly thin, so you don't want to use the lightest wood in your collection. Now, I have hinted at a method that I use, and so I'm going to show that method today. In the future, we may explore some of the other methods so that you will get other perspectives on how to do it. But my method is what's called the built-up fan method. So I'm going to cut a series of blocks of wood, and I'm going to fan them out like this from a central point to build up my block of wood. So instead of all this here, that material is already absent from the start, so I'm not wasting it. You got to decide what you want to do. I'm going to carve the first layer, the leading edge, from this piece of wood because it's harder than the others. It'll go softer further and further back. Just as an example, this one I alternated so the first layer here, because this is a five-layer blade, this one is hard, the second one is soft, the next one is hard, and then the last two are soft. That's just another approach to how to get it done. So with all of that yammering out of the way, I am going to measure out with my ruler a series of 18 inch long pieces here. And we're going to cut these to size. So there's the first one. Go ahead and show. Oops. I'm going to mark on my center line here, so this blank is 18 inches. I want a mark at my 9-inch point. I want it dead center, middle of the blade, or middle of the blank. And now we will just drill straight down through this. Ideally, you would use something a little more accurate than this, but this will work. And so I'll carve a few more, cut a few more of these, and then we'll come back. Alright, so we have a stack of blocks. They are all drilled through the middle, hardest one on top. Now, the next thing we need to do is establish the angle that we are going to glue these all at, so that we can get the proper pitch angle throughout our blade, and that is determined by something called pitch to diameter ratio. So for a plane like this one, fairly clean endurance rubber model, freewheeling propeller, we want to be above pitch diameter ratio of 1.2. I'm going to go for about 1.3 on this airplane, so that'll give me a balance between efficiency and ease of trimming the airplane. I don't go for super rocket-like climbs on freewheeling equipped airplanes, or really short-coupled ones like this. You can trim this airplane to go up like a freaking bullet. I don't want to do that. So I'm going to go for kind of a medium pitch range that will let me go for a nice long motor run. So the best way for you to find this information is to type in something that will take you to the nlemma.com pitch calculator. The title of the page actually is Fundamentals of Propeller Pitch somethings or other, but it has a calculator on it, and I have the slowest internet in the world because it's still loading. I have an indoor model supply propeller pitch gauge for indoor models. It has a little slider up here that you put your propeller in, very similar to the one that we sell. This is admittedly a much more refined tool. It's also bulkier than ours, which is why we don't sell one quite like this. But a beautiful tool. I believe Jake Palmer was the guy that made a lot of these. Regardless, very cool. Jake is a former US team member, actually current US team member for F1D. But the bottom line is, I'm gonna use this little guy at the 8-inch station, because this thing won't fit out at the 9-inch station, to set my pitch. 18-inch propeller. Oopsie daisy. 18-inch propeller, and I want a pitch diameter of 1.3. 18-inch diameter propeller, I want a pitch diameter ratio of 1.3, so that gives me a pitch of 23.4 inches. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to go to the pitch calculator here, because I'm too lazy to compute out the math, but you know, the proper way. So our pitch is 23.4 inches, and our radius is at 8 inches. Because I've got this set at the 8-inch station. So you see right there. And then press next. And I get an angle of 24.96, 25 degrees. So we are going to set this guy right here for 25 degrees. And it will need torquing down because it's not staying put. So the way we're going to do this is we're going to set the first of our planks down here. Now we will bring the second one into play. And I'm just going to do an initial check here to make sure everything is good. There we go. So it looks like that's going to end me up. I'm going to overlap not like that on the ends. The one thing you want to watch is that you want to make sure your blanks here are straight. So if you've got one blank that's straight and another that is curved, then you'll end up with a different pitch on this side than you do on this side. Get the camera. There we go. And we'll throw one more on here on camera. Now, I had a conversation with my buddy Don DeLoach about correct sizing for this airplane, and he recommended a 2-inch propeller cord. So right around here is where you want to take that measurement, about 2/3 of the way out on the blade. and we're over 2 inches. So that means this blade is actually done. Blade. Blank. Sorry, I made another propeller some other time. So there you have it. Only 3 layers needed. There's you a pitch diameter 1.3 18-inch propeller block. We will not be doing any more of the work inside. By the way, one thing I do want to mention is you want to make sure you have correct rotation. This is the correct direction of rotation. So if I put this on the front of my airplane, it turns forward and rolls the airplane to the left, which is convenient because I've memorized that direction to crank everything, and everybody uses propellers that direction, so just do it. It's better for everybody. Don't make backwards propellers, please. Please, don't do it. Some people call this the most therapeutic part of model airplane building. I don't know. I never really felt it was that way, but there is something cool about carving away on a block. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to start carving the top of the propeller blade, and then I'll start carve the bottom. Some people prefer to start on the bottom. Your choice. I'm going to use a razor plane to take away a lot of material fairly consistently on here. I'll try to put a link down in the description. I actually did a tutorial on the flight test forum where I showed some of this several years ago. I have no idea where, but bottom line is this part is going to take you a while, and I am not about to show all of it. Some would say this is some pretty mesmerizing stuff to watch, though.
Alright, so we have this guy going on here. A few gouges. I would clean those up, be concerned about them, but the fact is we're going to carve pretty far into that yet. I still have about almost an eighth of an inch thickness leeway here at the tips. So there's still plenty to do, because you want your tips to be carved out real nice and thin. Bottom line is, this is the top of our airfoil. We've set it up to where we can't have a whole lot of camber, and that will force us to resist the urge to carve in a bunch of under camber on the bottom. I used to use a lot of under camber in my blades because I had read old articles indicating it was good. It's not. Just say no to lots of under camber on propeller blades. Also say no to having your hubs be stupendously thick, so you're gonna have to carve a lot of this away. Yes, this is a terrible technique. Deal with it. It's my technique. Can't deny that they're mesmerizing. Okay, so we have the top face, or this is actually the back face. So if this is the front of our propeller, this is actually the back face. Front face is actually the part that presses the air back. If you look closely, let me see if I can focus this at the camera. Yeah, there we go. You can actually see a slight curvature this way, which means I have started to develop a little bit of under camber right here. And that's all the under camber I want. Now, we'll come back to this, is where I have to thin this down, particularly out at the tips. We'll want to be real careful. We can plane it, or we can start using a sanding block. But the bottom line is, let's move on to the other blade. I do want to show very briefly the method most people use is to do this. And this works very well. I don't feel that I have as much control using this method, because if the grain goes wonky any place, my blade starts to dig in. And so that's why I primarily use a razor plane nowadays to carve my propellers. But I have carved very nice propellers. In fact, the big folding prop I showed, carved with a knife like this. So use what you feel comfortable with, and have fun. So, there's your one blade, mostly profiled. Needs to be sanded up here, and then thinned out some more, because it's like constant thickness from here out, and this needs to get much thinner. But, there you go. Do the same thing over here on the other side, and there you go. What you think? What you think of the propeller? Do you like it? Not really? No? No propeller? Okay. So, we have all this such like, and I forgot to bring what I really needed, which was scissors. Oh well. Alright, so what I'm going to do here is pull this alongside here. We're just going to roughly trace the outline of this guy. I want to thin down the back of this propeller hub a little bit. Kind of like that. And then we'll curve it around like this. And then we'll realize, hey, I should have brought scissors out here. But that's a fairly good propeller blade shape. Maybe taper down a little bit more here. Like that. Alright, so I've got this guy cut out here. So, mark all this off. Now the problem is we're all fat-soid right here. So what I'm going to do is pull it around. I want to cut part way up into the second layer. Just like that. And then we'll go repeat that on the other side. This blade is actually a little wider than the other blades, so we're going to start off by narrowing it down. Found that out because I used this one to make the template. And then found out the other side was narrower than that. Did mommy give you a haircut? question?
As? No, as ones.
Hmm. Let Daddy work on his propeller. So here we have a pretty nice looking prop. Now we're kind of fat right in here. Blades are thick, need to be tapered down, and then we'll be most of the way done here.
So what I'm going to do is kind of definitely use a razor blade for this. And so we don't really get this too thin. What I'm trying to do is kind of put them here like this. Nice controllable handle.
One laid down, one to go. And there is a propeller. All nice and pretty like. Very nice, pretty curvature.
Now that we have our propeller carved out and looking all beautiful, we need to make it and our nose block get along as close friends. So one of the first things that we're going to do is we're going to go ahead and we're going to stick a prop bearing in this nose block. I ran into some issues with not having the right size nose bearings and whatnot. So the bottom line is I have a nose bearing I drilled out for 1/16 inch propeller shaft, and we're going to pull that into service. We're going to lather the snot out of this thing with glue because it's going to be under fairly substantial loads. Very substantial. But I don't have the right size drill bits to do this correctly, because the correct way to do this would be to sink this into a... actually slice the back off of this bearing, mount it at one end of an aluminum tube, mount the rest of the bearing at the other, so you have one bearing here, and one bearing here, and one further back, but make do with what you got. Bottom line is I want to have a little bit of down and right thrust, and get past this stage as quickly as possible, because this is not what y'all are here for. So, nose block is dealt with. Now, I have gone ahead and I've cut to size a lot of the parts that I'm going to need. So I'm going to need a piece of 3/32 brass tubing. That is going to fit onto my propeller shaft, which I'm going to have to cut loosely to size now. So, got a propeller shaft, I've got this piece of brass tubing, which is going to serve as a sleeve. And so it's going to absorb all the tension of my rubber motor. Now, there's a reason that this piece of brass tubing won't go in there. We may not be able to use that bearing yet because it is fitting way too tight. I picked an oversized drill bit to drill it. So, come back to that in a bit then. So prop shaft with a little bit of resistance, there we go, prop shaft goes in, the bearing sleeve slides over, and that's what rides against our propeller shaft, or propeller bearing I should say. May want to have a secondary bearing on that, we'll try to get one set up for it. And then there's going to be an outer tube that's going to be glued into our propeller that will ride over that particular tube. So let's do that now. This needs to be brass because it's going to be under obscene amounts of tension. The outer tubing we want to be a little bit softer so that it can be made to comply with any bending that occurs, because you're not going to be able to pull the prop shaft loose or anything like that. I mean, you're committed once you've got this on here. Now, the way that I like to cut aluminum tubing is to take a knife that I don't care about quite as much keeping sharp. And now I have that broken off. And now I need to go find my sandpaper. Length of this tubing just to make sure perfect. So now we will drive this one in part way. Glue. There we go. Graceful. Next victim. There we go. That's what I want. This to slide back out of the way. Just like that. And so now we have the outer tube that needs to have this inner tube sanded a little more. There we go. Props going to need to be balanced too, so I'll shave off some material here until it balances. We're going to still need to varnish this propeller and whatnot as well. So now the next step is not to bend that over, because we need something to engage here. So take a sacrificial piece of wire here. So there needs to be something to transfer the torque here on my prop shaft into my propeller, but then that needs to let go of the propeller when the motor unwinds, so that the propeller can spin freely and not create a bunch of drag. So we've got to create some sort of a clutch. So the clutch I'm going to use is what is called a Nason clutch. It was invented by somebody by the last name of Nason, who's a member of Flying Aces Club. This has become my preferred clutch over the past few years. And the reason I really like it is it engages very reliably, because it's basically impossible for it to not engage. way that we are going to make this device is we are going to create a little curved shape like this. I want it to be fairly broad across here. Degree bend. Oh, remember I made that example bend right here. This guy needs some sanding as well. So what I want is for this to be mounted here so the propeller shaft comes in and locks into this and pulls it around. So I'm going to make another bend out here. Probably going to be a little too steep of an angle. Last thing I need is for this thing to let go on me, because I don't want stitches from the prop shaft coming free and spinning around. My flying buddies, Dorman Crawford, had that happen last year, I think it was. Got him up pretty good. He got stabbed by the propeller shaft when it came free and then dug into his hand. So here's a hint, rubber power airplanes can actually be quite cruel to your body. All right, so here's the bottom line. I have this thing that is a rocker arm. It's got two claws, they sit up here like this, and they rock back and forth. Now, this is sitting out front. I want to bury this down into the propeller to make it look nice and also to work a little bit better. Now we're going to take a razor blade and we're going to cut back along the propeller bearing here, pretty deep into the propeller hub. Make another parallel cut. This, and we will go ahead and pop that out. And I'm going to save that piece. I'm going to cut a chunk out of it. Now I gotta figure out where I sent my clutch off to. Oh yes, right in front of me. And so I'm gonna drop it down into that slot. So we will carefully put glue in there while keeping it free from our clutch, which is not the easiest thing to do. Made a lot of these Nason clutches and it is indeed possible to screw them up. The biggest concern I've got is that's too steep of an angle. Because under load, that much load, that could flex back. So we are going to relax this guy back a little more. And that was too much. Dang it. That is just right. So now we will squirt more glue down in there and replace the piece of wood that we took out. While desperately trying to get glue into, avoid getting glue into the tube and somewhat failing. But there we go. Buried down in there. Now, I don't entirely trust all that to hold, so I'm going to take some Kevlar and I'm going to wrap it with Kevlar thread and harden that with CA. I'm using Kevlar because I have it. You could use spider wire, which is my kind of preferred thing because it's cheap and readily available. Even thread could be made to work. Made my tube a little bit on the short side and come back to bite me. But this guy is secure. I'll put some accelerator on it to get it all in there. And there we go. So fancy pants little clutch is in. I have two little pieces of brass tubing back here to serve as washers. So we're going to slide this guy on. And give ourselves some clearance out the back. Like that. No, sorry. Like that. So now I will grab this beast If I have the pliers. Get out of the way, you. Maybe I'm gonna have a little bit of trouble bending this guy. I don't always have this problem, but when I. There we go. Almost there. And if you think that bending this 1/16th wire is fun, or is, you know, whatever. 3/32 a real blast. Okay. You're going to be stubborn. Because the reality is, I need this to be swept back ever so slightly. Doesn't pull the prop shaft forward, or pull the prop forward on there quite as much. So now I have this assembly, as you can see. Just like that. Slips back, is completely free of it. So, there's how to make a pretty awesome propeller. The only thing that you really need to do after that is to varnish it. If you think you're going to be flying in some rough territory, maybe line the leading edge with a little bit of fiberglass or something. You could actually have planed a flat in here and laid in some basswood as a leading edge and then sand that in. That'd be really nice and durable. I've done that on a few props and it works pretty awesome. Like when you're ROGing off of pavement or something like that, that's pretty nice. Fiberglass though works very, very, very effectively on that as well. So the other thing I would mention is if you see any sign of this chewing in here, lay some plywood, like 1/64th ply down on the facing, and that'll take care of that problem. So that's been how to make a carved freewheeling propeller using the fan block method, laminated fan method, sorry. We will probably try to do some more in the future. Y'all put some questions and comments down below telling us what else you'd like to see on this topic or others, and we'll take a look at it. And by the way, to the people who've talked about a foam rubber powered airplane, something of that nature, just be patient. It's coming. It is coming, I promise. We'll see you.
Hi, I'm Josh Finn. This is Hope. We are J&H Aerospace.
If you like this video, hit the like button.
Also, how about subscribe to our channel and check out jhaerospace.com for new free flight products and all of the tooling that you'll need to build them.
Thanks for watching.